Konnichiwa. Today, we're going to talk about the rational approach to learning Japanese kanji and vocabulary, which will make it far more efficient and enable you to learn more rapidly. The thing about Japanese vocabulary that distinguishes it from most languages is that it has three elements. It has sound, kanji, and meaning. Most languages, as we know, have only two of those elements, sound and meaning. The spelling may be a bit eccentric, but that's rather a minor problem. So the fact that Japanese includes this third, rather large element of kanji, intimidates a lot of people, because they think there's this much more to learn, it makes it this much bigger a job. And that's only partly true, because there's a fallacy involved here. And partly because of this fallacy, the way in which most conventional sources encourage you to learn Japanese kanji and vocabulary means that this quantity problem, the problem of the extra quantity of material to learn in the form of kanji, really does become the handicap it appears to be. So what's the fallacy? The fallacy really is that human memory and the question of memorizing things is not purely a question of quantity. The human mind has an enormous capacity for retention, and we can prove this with a simple experiment that we've all done on various occasions, which is when you perhaps watch a movie or an anime or a television program that you saw maybe 10 years ago, and you think you don't remember any of it. When you watch it, in most cases, you start remembering things. You say, oh yes, I remember that scene, and I remember what he says after that. So the first thing that this shows is that you actually are retaining an enormous amount. If you multiply this by all the movies and programs and things you've ever seen, you have a tremendous amount of information tucked away inside your brain, most of it useless. But the second point this raises is the question of how is it that you remember all this when maybe if somebody asked you, if you'd seen the program, you wouldn't even be absolutely certain, and you certainly didn't remember anything about it at the beginning. Well, the way you remember these things is because memory works by hooks and triggers. So once you start seeing the movie, you get various hooks and triggers which dredge memories out of the deep recesses of your storage vaults. Now, the thing this shows us is that memory, memorizing things, recalling things, is not so much a question of storage, retention, capacity, as of retrieval. An awful lot of material is actually there. The question is, can you retrieve it? Can you build the pathways that allow you to get at it quickly whenever you need it? And this is the fundamental problem in learning vocabulary of any kind. Now, because of this, the fact that there are three elements to a word, the kanji, the meaning, and the pronunciation, actually potentially gives us more hooks, more triggers that we can use to improve the retrievability of our vocabulary. Now, the second problem, as I said, is the way people are encouraged to go about learning vocabulary and kanji, and that is essentially by separating them. Now, the logic of this is based in the quantitative approach, which I've just talked about, the idea that because there's a large quantity to learn, it's good to break it down into two separate areas, kanji and vocabulary. But because the real problem isn't fundamentally a storage problem, but a retrieval problem, this is absolutely the wrong approach. What we need to do is learn pronunciation, meaning, and kanji all at the same time, to treat words, in other words, as words. Because that way, we're using all three data points together, the meaning, the pronunciation, and the kanji, any one of which can act as the trigger or the hook in any given case. And this is why right from the beginning in my book, Alice in Candyland, which is there to give people a basic vocabulary and understanding of kanji before they get to the point of being able to immerse, although Alice in Candyland is in theory a kanji book, I never teach a kanji on its own. At no point in that book, and in the Anki deck associated with it, will you find a kanji that's not part of a word where you know the meaning, the sound, and the kanji all at the same time. Now, how do we build the links that connect these three elements together? If you know the sound sisters, this helps a lot, because even if you've never seen a kanji before, you can very often make an excellent guess at how it sounds, because it will have one element in it that tells us the sound with a pretty good degree of accuracy. So the sound sisters help us to overcome one of the problems, which is linking kanji to sound. And I recommend, wherever you think there may be a need for it, that's to say where you aren't confident that you'll remember easily, I recommend making some kind of a mnemonic to link together the meaning and the sound. Because the kanji has natural links to the meaning and very often natural links to the sound. Meaning and sound need to be linked together in our mind. Once we've got that, if we can then, from the kanji, get an idea of the sound, then we also get the meaning. If we get an idea of the meaning, then we very often also get the sound. The three things are working together as they should to mutually increase retrievability. So what kind of sound to meaning mnemonics should we make? Well, ideally Japanese to Japanese ones are good, but it doesn't really matter what they are. They can be English or any other language. The important thing is to get those two things linked together in your mind. But a lot of the time we do make Japanese to Japanese mnemonics, and we make them very easily. And the reason for this is another thing that scares beginners, but is in fact a good friend. And that is what are called homophones. That's to say, words that sound identical, but have different meanings and different kanji. Now these are very daunting if you try to do something silly, like learning lists of homophones. Please never try to do that. But they become very useful when we've learned one word and then we learn another word that's pronounced in the same way, because we can nearly always just tie those two together. We already know one of the words, it's already a part of our working vocabulary, so we can use that as a link for the other word. So for example, if you follow my videos, you probably know the word kaidan, which means a scary story, a ghost story. Now, if you're encountering it for the first time, you very likely already know the word kaidan, which means a staircase. So you could make a sound link for that word by picturing a ghost coming down the staircase. Now, later on, you may learn another word, kaidan, and this is a conversation or a conference between important people, you know, when politicians from different countries meet to discuss something or that kind of thing. It's called a kaidan. And this is where people start to get worried. Oh dear, there are three words and they're all pronounced the same. Isn't that worrying? Well, it's not worrying, because you use the staircase kaidan to help you to learn the ghost story kaidan. And now you've got a third kaidan. And how are you going to remember that? Well, the way I remember it is to say, you know, when all these important people get together behind closed doors discussing important things about world peace, what do you think they're really doing? They're just telling ghost stories. To give another example, you may know the word sado, which means tea ceremony. This is literally the way of tea, the road of tea, and sa is an on reading of cha, tea. Now, later on, you may learn the word sado, which means operating or functioning, usually referring to a machine, a piece of machinery. So, a good way to remember that is to picture robots holding a tea ceremony together. Now you can even cheat a bit with words. For example, if you're learning the word taiho, which means a big gun, a cannon, piece of artillery, maybe you already know the word taiho, which means arrest. Now those aren't homonyms, as you see. Taiho isn't the same pronunciation as taiho. But we could say, for example, that when the police are making a big arrest, they bring out the big guns. And of course we know it's a big arrest because it's bigger than just taiho. It's taiho. Now, using this technique, we tie sound and meaning together. The kanji are linked to the meaning because it's the meaning of kanji which gives us the meaning of the word. And I've already done videos on how that works, and I'm going to have more to say about it very soon. The kanji are also linked closely to the sound, because kanji have a narrow range of pronunciation, and they will limit the pronunciation possibilities even if you don't know the exact pronunciation in any given case. And there are things that will help us to get closer to that as well. And again, I'll be covering that very soon. The important thing here is that we tie together the sound and the meaning, the only two elements that don't have a natural link, so that the three are all linked together and can work together in our minds. We also put the sound on the back of the card, which can be done automatically with Yomi-chan, and I've explained that in another video. And in many cases, we can have definitions that reinforce our appreciation of the kanji, because we're using the same kanji in the definition as are used in the original word. I've talked a little bit about that in our last lesson, and I'm going to do a much fuller lesson on that in the near future. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comments below, and I will answer as usual. I'd like to thank my Gold Kokeshi patrons who make these videos possible, and all my patrons and supporters on Patreon and everywhere who not only make these videos practically possible, but also tell me that these are really something worth doing, something that my dear friends and supporters really appreciate. And believe it or not, that's something a near-sentient, self-learning android actually needs. And of course, I'd like to thank you for attending this lesson. Kore kara mo yoroshiku onegai shimasu. Class dismissed.